Thanks, Terry, and thanks, everybody, for coming today. So I'm going to talk more about the infrastructure side of the implementation that we've done at JBJS. So this is what I'm going to quickly cover today. We'll start with an overview of JBJS and the product mix, just to give you a lay of the land for anybody who's not familiar with us as a publisher. I'll tell you about the environment that led to our solution. I'll share with you the infrastructure pieces that we had in place to work with when we constructed our solution. I'll cover some of the considerations that we had that were relevant to us and that will probably be relevant to you as well. You'll see the solution that we architected. Also talk about those important things, cost and timeline. And Christina, you're going to preview her slides. My colleague is going to talk about the editorial side of video at JBJS. So JBJS is an STM publisher. We produce a family of print publications, online publications, and learning products that are all related to the field of orthopedics. These include the Journal of Bone and Joint Surgery, JBJS Case Connector, JBJS Essential Surgical Techniques, and JBJS Reviews. Our flagship publication, JBJS, is celebrating 125 years of publication this year. And it is the gold standard in peer-reviewed information in the field of orthopedics. So Case Connector and Surgical Techniques are online-only journals that launched in 2011. Case Connector leverages semantic technology to help surgeons establish patterns between case reports, patient case reports of rare and unusual cases. Surgical Techniques does just what it says. It illustrates some of the commonly used surgical techniques in orthopedic surgery. JBJS Reviews is our newest online journal, having just reached 6 months of publication. And it features thorough critical reviews of published knowledge on topics of interest and importance to orthopedic surgeons. So in addition to the online journal with reviews, we also have tablet apps for the Apple and Android. So what was the environment like in late 2012, 2013, when we started thinking about our solution? So our authors have been submitting video that accompanied our articles since 2004, but we were seeing an uptick in submissions. I was very interested to hear Henry say that that's when they started getting video as well. So something was in the water, and people started generating those videos. So we did not have a dedicated way to accept video, and our authors frequently had problems getting us their files. We also had a limited number of file types that we could take. On the website, our only option was to treat these videos as supplementary material. Readers had to navigate to find the article, then go to the toolbox that went with the article, shown here on the right. Then find that little red box there that said supplemental content. Click on it, which opened another little pop-up, which you see a supplemental content pop-up. Then they had to click on the content link, and then you had to download the video, and another pop-up opened, and then they watched the video. So not the best user experience. You've probably all seen a video like this. Not great. The files took a long time to download, and playback was really dependent on the media setup that the user had on their desktop. We weren't standardizing the files. We were just putting up basically what we were getting from the authors. So in 2013, our web hosting platform, then Silverchair, developed the capability to show videos in line with the article content rather than as a data supplement. So we began using this new feature basically as soon as it was available for all of the new articles that were published on all three journals. So as you can see from this example here, the reader sees the video in line as part of the article content. So they're scrolling down, they see the video like they would see a figure. To watch the video, all they have to do is click on it. Also, back in 2011, we had done a reader survey and market research that showed us that 70% of our subscribers were using video in various sites, various places, to stay informed, stay educated, and connected to the orthopedic community. So we knew that video is going to be increasingly important to us and to our leaders. So we carved out a new position on the editorial board for deputy editor for video, and we hired an orthopedic surgeon to fill that spot. We felt it was important to have somebody who knew the content and could review the content in that position. We were also accredited to start granting our own continuing medical education credits, and we're also getting advertising interest for video on the sites. So on the infrastructure side, we had Aries Editorial Manager, which we still use, and authors are submitting manuscripts for all four systems through this system. We had an account for Bright Cove through Silverchair, through our Silverchair licensing agreement, and that was intended for us to be able to upload videos for inclusion on the platform. Unfortunately, we did not have and still don't have an internal content management system. Probably like many of you, we have an internal network drive that is, in our case, organized by paper and a very tight file naming convention to keep our files organized. So the video files were stored with other assets for the paper. We also had developed a FileMaker database for manuscript tracking. So we knew we were at a crossroads, and we needed a unified way to deal with the video. So we took a step back and we gathered information. We looked at how the video moved through the various processes, the systems, and the vendors. We talked to our vendors about their plans for video, and we looked at the options for customizing. So this led us to look at a more robust standalone license for Bright Cove, so we could take advantage of the APIs. APIs are application programming interfaces that let you develop a program that will talk to a system. So this was our first step in visualizing our plans for video. Those of you from GEGS remember this whiteboard. We looked at the systems and the people that touched video basically in the publishing ecosystem. And we began to think about Bright Cove as a central repository for GEGS video. We imagined having a custom video submission system. We map the flow of video from each step as a manuscript moves from submission to acceptance to copy editing to production to appearing on the website. We looked at all those steps. We mapped the interaction of advertising video with the central repository. How would that work? And then we looked at how would the websites interact with a central repository. So we looked at all the pieces that needed to know about video and mapped how they could work with it. So, given that diagram, what to do. So our mapping had shown us really that a central repository based on Bright Cove, the video cloud system, would centralize storage, but it would also support the activities associated with the pre-production, production, advertising, and education. So it seemed like a really good fit for us. Aries, who makes Editorial Manager, had also told us that they were going to soon be releasing a way to include a link with an article submission. Doesn't sound like a big deal, but it was. And we had conversations with a third-party developer about creating that video submission system. So this resulted in a high-level spec that we then turned into a level of effort estimate. So these were our main goals and considerations when architecting the solution. So the main things here are streamlining and optimizing. We had to make our authors' lives easier. If we wanted more video, it really had to be easy for them to provide it to us. And we wanted to accept virtually any kind of video. We wanted to have a minimum number of conversions, though, to keep the quality of the video high. If you accept the video and you convert it, you downsample and downgrade the quality of the video. So we were trying to keep the number of times we had to touch the video as small as possible. We also wanted to make our editors, reviewers, and internal staff's lives easier as well, because at each stage of the process, as the video moved with the paper through the production, the video had to be downloaded in order to be viewed. And they had the same problems that everybody else had. We wanted to get the video into the repository where it would be finally played from at the outset of the process. We didn't want to have to move the video from place to place to place as it went through the cycle as well. We had an absolute requirement not to let other authors see what, let the author who submitted the paper not see what other authors might be working on and the videos that they may have submitted. Yet they needed to be able to get us updated or revised video. So we needed to have a way for them to be able to search the repository for their paper and provide us new video, but not see what else was going on. On the financial side, our solution really had to work with the existing manuscript submission system and our web hosting solutions. So that included Silverchair and Highwire. We had to capitalize on the inline viewing capability, so we wanted to improve our readers' use of the video. And we also wanted to be certain that the video was being optimized for delivery, so that the readers who are, once they found the article with the video, would have a terrific viewing experience. And we wanted a solution that would grow with us and not require on-site hardware or software. We really wanted a solution that we could scale. Of course, it had to be not too expensive. So Brightcove was an easy choice for us. Not only does it provide the video storage, but it also provides streaming. And we contracted with our third-party developer to build a video submission system that sits between Editorial Manager, where the author first starts their paper submission, and Brightcove. So I'll show you that in a minute. So the videos don't have to be moved in order for us to play them from the site. We're loading them at the outset where they need to be. And we also took advantage of the ARIES work to link the Brightcove video to the author's paper. So Christina will show you that process. So here's a simplified view of the architecture that we set up. So in the top left, we see our happy author with his paper and video. Is ready to submit to one of our JBJS journals. And then during the submission process, he's linked to the video submission system, which behind the scenes is talking to the Brightcove repository. The author never sees the Brightcove repository directly. They don't even really realize that that's where the video is going. But as part of the process, that's where we're storing the video. Unfortunately, there is no API for Editorial Manager for us to take that video submission information and stash it back in the author's paper. So that's a manual step that the author has to do, but that was acceptable from our point of view. So our developer was also able to leverage the video submission system and create a secret backdoor for our advertising manager to upload advertising video into Brightcove. That's her on the bottom left. She's happy with her files. So during the pre-production and production, our reviewers, editors, and internal staff are accessing the Brightcove repository directly. That's them on the top. You can't tell it, but they're happy to. And at the bottom, you see our happy readers who are getting the video in line on the website. The Brightcove video player is what's called they call a smart player. It delivers video in either Flash or HTML5, depending on the viewer's device capabilities. Multiple renditions of the files are created to serve the highest quality file that the user's bandwidth will support. So this includes lower bandwidth resolutions for mobile, suitable for delivery over mobile networks. Once you set your defaults in the Brightcove system, the system handles the transcoding and rendition creation. Those of you who care about that. The ability to tweak these settings came with the enterprise version that we purchased. If you need to, you can create up to 10 renditions of each file with the Brightcove system. And we're using the H.264 codec with an MP4 container. Okay. So here are the file types that we're accepting. This just gives you a snapshot of what we were able to do before and after. Suffice it to say, big improvement. Here's a look inside the video, the Brightcove Video Cloud repository. The metadata, we have the authors and our metadata when they submit their videos. We build what's called a playlist, and all the video that is associated with one paper is loaded into a playlist. Here at the top, you see one playlist that has 9 videos. If you open up the playlist, you see the video, the separate videos that are part of the playlist. It looks like the original submission started in March, and then the first video was resubmitted and reloaded in April. You can dive down more then to see details on the individual videos, preview the videos. Don't worry, I'm not going to show you the surgical video. So what did it cost? As I mentioned, had to get an enterprise version of the Brightcove account to get the API access. That was a $10,000 investment for the first year, and that would be a recurring cost. You can see the specs here on what we get with that setup, and you can scale the solution that you choose up or down depending on how much video you have to deal with. It cost us about $5,000 to build the video submission system, which was pretty reasonable. And we've just sent somebody to training for Adobe Premiere. So a timeline, how long did this take? It was roughly 9 months from the time we started the conversations until we launched the system. There was a lot of downtime in there while we're focusing on other projects.
Sorry. By reminder.
Okay, so we got our Brightcove account in April, and our developer turned things around pretty quickly. In May, we were looking at the first version of the site. By the end of August, the video submission site was about 90% done. And then, don't you know it, the day we were planning to launch the system, we were attacked. We had a hacker attack. And the lovely setup that Christina had done in editorial manager was accidentally deleted. So luckily this was not really publicized. This was our own internal date. And we were able to turn things around pretty quickly and by the 15th of January get things up and running. The first video was submitted with the system at the end of January. So what's next? Maintenance. We're always having maintenance to do. We're doing some work on branding, and we're hoping at the end of the year to be looking at a content management system. So we're managing the other assets internally, and we'll figure out how this fits there. We'll also be looking at developing new products and looking for new ways to use video on the site. So this is just to look at some of the sites and how we're using video now. That's it.
Great. Thank you.